votes for, 25 against and 1 abstention. Okay?
Like Groundhog Day.
We now move on to the recommendations in parts 4 and 5 of the employment panel. I'd like the leaders of the council to move these recommendations. Can all just one vote on 4 and 5? We have to do that. And seconded. Okay, those in favour of recommendations 4 and 5, all those in favour, please show. Okay, there's one abstention, which is my vote. Councillor Blakely wants to record his vote again, so. Do you want to do the numbers, or we know the numbers? People happy to know the numbers? Yeah. Okay, now we want Councillor Spear requested to approve the recommendations contained in part 2 of the resolution, minute 3 of the panel, which considered the director and resource for the point. If you'd like the leader to move those for approval.
So moved.
And are they seconded? And I invite anyone who wants to vote in favour of this recommendation, please show. All those in favour. And is anyone against? No. One abstention. Okay.
Decision to pause was to enable council to identify efficiencies and savings
prior to embarking on a new model for delivery, for example, sharing the shared services model with another authority. This position was fully instilled by our colleagues in Cheshire West and Cheshire Council and did not impact on our positive working relationship. Our external auditors supported our decision to pause, highlighting in our most recent annual audit letter that there was, quote, clear evidence of further cost-benefit analysis being completed ahead of the decision to postpone pursuing the shared services arrangement with a neighbouring council while the future council programme is taken forward. External audit also concluded that our programme of remodelling and identifying further savings and efficiencies will seek to ensure that resources are used effectively to achieve the outcomes needed by residents and that required savings are secured. Mr. Mayor, the establishment of an internal transaction centre, which is responsible for processing transactions within the authority, builds on the concept defined through the shared services initiative with Cheshire West and Chester. And we will deliver savings through combining and streamlining processes, generic working, integration and flexibility amongst teams, reduced overheads, leaner management structures and spans of control, shared systems administration and business support, and reduction of transaction costs. Mr. Mayor, this will deliver short-term savings, with savings of £1.1 billion delivered through reconfiguring the teams as staff move into the transaction centre, and further savings of £729,000 proposed in future years as the business model is fully developed. Finally, Mr. Mayor, once the transaction centre is established and fully operational, this will place the council, I believe, in a strong position to explore alternative models in the future with the potential to deliver further savings and bring about even greater benefits for this council. This could include shared service with Cheshire West, Manchester, or indeed another authority. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, that's question been answered. We now move on to item 10, which are matters we created from the Policy and Performance Committee. I call on the chair of the Performance Committee, Councillor Paul Roberts, to move these presentations and have a second there.
Clear lack of respect from council officers. there will be one voice clearly stated they do not wish to see a fire station in their village. Their tenacity and hard work is an example of people power in action. This is their victory and nobody else's. And let it be a message to this council that people have spoken, do not allow any more development in the centre of Greasby. Mr. Mayor, the Labour notice of motion is yet another example of them blaming everything on the national government.
Councillor Anderson, I just want to check on a statement you made. It would not be appropriate for this full council to make any pre-development decisions on any planning application that might arise in Greasby or anywhere else. So I would ask you to, in the sentiment of your vote, is to try and encourage members of the planning committee to have a pre-determination of development. I've asked some legal advice on that. I just want to clarify that, because you are in a public session. Would that be in order or out of order? Say it, please.
Yeah, I believe the representation makes a part of an issue of the management
of the campaign. Keep the same time, okay?
Okay, so I appreciate that, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for looking out for me. The Labour notice of motion, again, I'll just repeat that, blames everything on the national government and it don't take any responsibility when in power locally. It was this council that initially offered the site to Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, and this council who dithered for months, caused much anguish to residents before making a spectacular U-turn by the media. And if the leader of the council was so concerned about the fire station measures, why did he remain neutral subject until a couple of weeks ago? Yet again, it is an example of a Labour policy taking the vice of party politics and not governing in the best interest of the people. Mr. Mayor, in their notice of motion, we see another example of Labour's selective amnesia. How convenient that they forget to mention that it was their own government who started reducing fire authority budgets way back in 2004. Yes, for those interested in the facts, Mr. Mayor, this started in the Fire Service Rescue Act 2004, which has seen Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority budget reduced year on year for the last decade. Interestingly, Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority does remain the third most expensive in the country. I think fire station mergers in the current climate are unnecessary, and I would encourage all elected members not to play party politics, but to work for Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority.
But I think it's not at any cost, and I think it was the right decision to withdraw this site from any consideration of the new fire station and to extend the search in the wider Greasby area where the Chief Fire Officer is clearly saying for operational reasons that's the area it makes sense to build a new fire station in. But I do hope, Mr. Mayor, that in the same way that we've taken the lead in listening to the people and not playing part of politics, we can act in a sensible way in terms of finding an alternative site for what is clearly the right decision. I think the Chief Fire Officer said this is the least best decision, but given the scale of cuts he's facing, I think it is something we should consider. So I would, I haven't got a problem with agreeing with the Tory motion because it's very similar to ours, so I would we'd be supporting that and we'd also be moving our motion as well. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, are there any other speakers? We've got Councillor Blakely and Councillor Gilchrist. I'll take those two first, okay?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My colleague, Councillor Anderson, I welcome the council views, spectacular views, and I welcome the fact that listening to Peter, I certainly hope he adopts the same approach and listens to people of North West and Silver Matthew. Because let's face it, the leader of the council only withdrew this land in Greenby when the head of asset management offered up a piece of greenbelt land in Silver Matthew within 10 minutes of me having that conversation with the head of asset management. Your press release was sent out. It was a disgraceful, political, driven, and I do hope Mr. Mayor, it's a political decision. Thank you.
same principle should apply. If there's to be a further site, then the councillors in that area should be taken into consideration. They should be invited in to discuss the issues and try and reach a conclusion to put forward to the public. On the issue of Shropshire, I have no information either. But I did look back at the act that Tom referred to earlier. And yes, there was a discussion going on with John Prescott and the government at the time, and there was the introduction of a risk-based system. So that's the risk-based system that exists now. If you look at the risks and decide how long it will take to get somewhere and whether it meets the timescales involved. My reading as a chair of our officer's reports was all about where is the risk-based system and can we meet times to get to key places. But if there is to be further development, if for example we have a new local plan that releases more land in the borough for development in certain areas, and if the golf resort were to be taken off, and if there were to be hotels in that area, and there's to be further development, then we need a careful overall look at it to make sure we do have services in the right place. After all, Templeton Place was invented by the last government in 2009 and 10, and said authorities should work together. And those were models we commended at the time, models that need to be in place now, as long as everyone has confidence in them and is involved in them.
Okay, Councillor Green, Councillor Lane.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
prior authority across three parties all agreed that Merseyside is best served by fully trained, full-time firefighters. I've been fortunate enough now to be on the fire authority for a number of years, and I've probably been able to witness firsthand where we were 10 years ago to where we are now as a fire service for Merseyside. And clearly, most of our success in Merseyside has been built on the fact that we have put a huge emphasis on prevention. In other words, as everybody knows, you know, 100,000 home fire safety checks in 1 year, something to be really proud of in Merseyside. And clearly that still continues today. So we don't attend as many fires or incidents as we used to 10 years ago. And thank goodness for that. And fire deaths have decreased accordingly. But what I do have to say on this particular issue is the fire authority, for those members of the Labour members here who are members of the fire authority, I think we would all acknowledge that we don't really try to get into the mudslinging too often. Obviously, we should tie a little bit of party politics, because what we are concerned about is the safety of the residents of excuse me, I am losing my voice, which some of you will be very We are concerned about the safety of the lives of our residents and people who live in Merseyside. And what I would hope that all members of this authority have in their minds is clearly to keep that clear definition between what the fire authority have to make as a decision and what the Borough Council has to make as their decision when it comes to a planning issue. The two are not related, even though it may feel to local residents that they are. They are not related. They are two separate issues which must be dealt with quite separately. But my greatest concern, as I'm sure the members of the Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority will be, is to ensure the greatest safety of those people on West Wirral. I will have thoughts to them. But clearly, none of us like the idea that we have to merge fire stations, but we are where we are. And again, we can stop mudslinging whose fault it is. And I've been lobbying to the Labour government, to the Conservative government, for extra funding for Merseyside, and I will continue to do that. But we have to make savings. We are where we are. And the only way we can do that on Wirral is to offer a merger of a fire station. And mergers are closed, whichever way you look at it. But it's the best option that we have for Wirral. In Liverpool, it's not just a Labour-controlled fire authority saying to Wirral, this is what you're having because, you know, we're the wicked Labour Party. It's not happening in Liverpool. Liverpool are having outright closures. We are not having outright closures in Wirral. We are being offered the opportunity of mergers. Excuse me. And the fire authority primary concern has to be the safety of the people. 26,000 people in the west of Wirral, Hoyle, West Kirby, their paramount safety has to be at the forefront of all we do. So I hope really that Wirral will obviously play their part in this, as local councillors and as members of the full council, but clearly please keep in your mind the actual local government.
Okay, thank you. Well, Councillor Hodgson has indicated, and there's no one else indicating that I'll move the seconds.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I know the guilty is on, so it'll be about 30 seconds. We'll look on track.
Heard from the chief fire officer that the checklist contracts to get by with the fuel stations. The head of asset management is obliged when asked to identify land in council control, and that is not making an offer. No request ever came to me, Mr. Mayor, as the cabinet member responsible for asset management, to make any decision to transfer central to these lands to the fire service. Because such a request had come to me, I would not have made a decision under delegated powers. I would perhaps have consulted the councillors in each ward first. The councillor Blakey's case, of course, he doesn't want that sort of consultation, as he's told me about him. But the likelihood is I would maybe prefer to direct for the cabinet decision to be made in public session. Fire service officers, Mr. Mayor, came down, I understand, very strongly indeed, in favour of central Greasby, as their judgment was that it had the greatest merit, judged against response times and risk to the 26,000 Wirral residents who they serve. The service was looking to embrace a range of facilities 24/7, very much in accord with people's wishes. And nevertheless, Mr. Mayor, we have listened on how we go on the site. Whatever land is finally identified, Mr. Mayor, it's the fire authority as new owners who will in any case need to obtain planning permission. The planning process is quite straightforward, it's transparent. Residents can object and raise their objections to the council of all parties on the planning committee. The mere granting of planning consent is centered entirely in the transfer of ownership, and that could only be agreed by the cabinet and ultimately by council. Now, having heard the depth of feeling of local residents against the central Greenby site, our professional officers are identifying all other potentially available alternatives, and there can be no question, Mr. Mayor, of any council land being released until all these processes have been exhausted. And I think it is quite wrong of Conservative councillors to attempt to make political capital of this and to imply to the public that offers were made when they know very well it would be constitutionally impossible for officers to obey offers.
Any abstentions, which is fine, okay, so we go with that directly.
one in the south, has that been recorded? 41, 21 and one abstention. Okay, so that is the vote on that notice of motion. If I do a very short tap dance, we'll take it into guilty.
These areas are experiencing the highest levels of low demand in the world. caused by the fact that since Sarnham was a vacant property and low prices and rental values, the introduction of a scheme in specific targeted areas would help stabilise these neighbourhoods by curbing the intention to drive the property standards and manners in the private sector, as well as helping to solve other issues contributing to low demand within a neighbourhood. A selective licensing scheme would require landlords in certain areas to purchase a licence from the council and commit to meeting certain requirements, including bringing the property up to a good standard in order to legally, in order to be legally allowed to put their homes on the rental market. A variety of methods will be used as part of the consultation to engage a range of stakeholders, including tenants, residents, landlords, service providers, council staff, members, and national and regional landlord organisations. The consultation results and the final selected license business rates will be reported back to Cabinet in the spring of 2015. I cannot express enough the importance of trying to drive up trends in these areas which have been identified as suffering from low demand. There are tremendous benefits for landlords, tenants, businesses and communities. The biggest benefit will be through seeing an improved confidence in the market and potential growth in property values in these areas. There will be better education and understanding for both tenants and their responsibilities to sustain the tenancy and landlords and their statutory responsibilities, written tenancy agreements and protected deposits. Ultimately, if there is a greater confidence in the local market, both improved image and desirability, all stakeholders will benefit from seeing fewer empty properties and those that are empty being empty.